Whether or not the 7800 XT sucks at VR is a valid question, because while testing the 7900 XTX and RX 7600, I ran into a fair number of problems when using those GPUs with my Quest 2. For several months after it first launched, the 7900 XTX had driver issues that made it underperform in VR. And on top of that, Meta took their sweet time updating the Oculus PC app. So even once AMD had fixed their drivers, games still didn't run right when using Quest Link on Radeon 7000 series GPUs. So to be able to play most of my games with both the 7900 XTX and the 7600, I had to use virtual desktop instead. But that was then, and this is now. It seems both AMD and Meta have finally gotten their crap fixed, because Half-Life Alyx ran great on the 7800 XT. I chose to test this game first because when making my 7900 XTX and RX 7600 videos, I ran into some issues with this game. Because of the driver issues early on, the 7900 XTX performed really poorly in this game in my initial review. And when testing the RX 7600 months later, both it and the 7900 XTX would only run Half-Life Alyx smoothly if I used virtual desktop. Like I already said though, I did not experience any of the same problems with the 7800 XT. I was able to run Half-Life Alyx at 4704 by 2384 on ultra fidelity. However, I did have to set the refresh rate to 90Hz to avoid any frame drops at those settings. Alyx is what I would call a medium-paced game, so 90Hz is actually perfect for it, and with the graphics on ultra, you get to see it in all its glory. The 7800 XT can run Half-Life Alyx at 120Hz at the same resolution as well, but you will have to turn the graphics down to high in order to maintain that constant 120fps. Honestly, I don't notice much difference visually between high and ultra. Alyx still looks amazing. The specific model of the 7800 XT I used for this video is the PowerColor Radeon RX 7800 XT Red Devil. I did all my testing for this video on my Ryzen 7 5800X3D test PC, which has 32GB of DDR4 3600 CL16 RAM, and all tests were run with resizable bar enabled. For all the benchmarks, I used a Quest 2 connected to my PC with a link cable, but to cover all the bases, I did try the 7800 XT with AirLink, and that worked fantastic as well. I did have one little issue I should tell you about, where when using Questlink or AirLink, it would default to an encode resolution of 2016 by 1120, even when the render resolution was set much higher than that, which left things looking kinda blurry. This was very easily overcome though by setting the encode width in the Oculus debug tool to 3680, and with link sharpening set to normal, that got things looking nice and crisp. While Questlink worked great with the 7800 XT, virtual desktop on the other hand exhibited a lot of stuttering, which I find weird because virtual desktop saved both the 7900 XTX and 7600 when I made those videos, because Questlink wasn't working well at the time. To see if it was a codec issue, I tried using H.264, then HEVC, and even AV1 with my Quest 3, but no matter the codec or other settings I used, or if I was using a Quest 2 or a Quest 3, I got stuttering with virtual desktop, which made playing games pretty uncomfortable. Real quick for those that are curious about AV1 encoding with the Quest 3. For whatever reason, I was only able to get AV1 encoding to work once. I got this capture, and then when I tried to enable AV1 encoding after that, virtual desktop wouldn't properly connect to my PC, and I'd just get a black screen whenever trying to launch a game. I tried rebooting my PC, rebooting my Quest 3, and even uninstalling and reinstalling virtual desktop. But despite all my efforts, the stuttering remained. Anyway, when I was able to use AV1, the stuttering was really bad. It was unpleasant with H.264 and HEVC, but absolutely unbearable with AV1. You can't see it so much in this capture because of the frame rate difference between the game and the capture, but I promise you, in the headset, the stuttering was horrific. If you look at the encoding time, we were at a pretty consistent 61 milliseconds, which compared to HEVC is about 10 times slower. Now, maybe I'm doing something wrong here, or there are some additional software and driver updates that need to take place to get better performance with AV1 encoding on the 7800 XT. I don't know for sure. I'm going to keep looking into this, but this is what I experienced. So that's my report for now. Getting back to the games, Pavlov is one I had a fair amount of trouble with in my RX 7600 video. I'm not sure what exactly was causing the problem in that video, but after doing some troubleshooting, I believe it was some kind of software bug in the Oculus PC app. It seems that bug has now been fixed, or simply doesn't affect the 7800 XT, because it had no problems playing Pavlov at all. And I had a great time dispatching enemies at 120Hz on ultra settings. Taking a look at another shooter, Contractors also ran at 120Hz at 4704x2384 with all the game settings on ultra. All that is but anti-aliasing, which I ended up setting too high. Performance in this game depends a lot on what map you're playing on. In most maps, I got a very stable 120fps at the settings I was using, with plenty of performance headroom to spare. But to really put the 7800 XT to the test, I needed to see how it performed in Contractor's parking lot map. More specifically, in this area right here. There's some lighting and shadows or something going on here that always pushes a GPU harder than any other area on any other map I've found. And the 7800 XT handled this area really nicely. Our performance headroom dipped down pretty good here, but it still churned out a stable 120fps. Another game I had performance issues with the RX 7600, was The Walking Dead Saints and Sinners. However, like our previous three games, the 7800 XT had no problems with this game at 120Hz, 4704x2384 ultra settings. I did turn anti-aliasing off though, because I don't like the way it softens the edges of things, making them look a little bit blurry. Turning it off does free up some performance headroom, which allowed me to bump up the pixel density a little to 110%. So I guess you could say, rather than using anti-aliasing, I prefer to take a super sampling approach. Looking at the performance headroom, I could have set the pixel density even higher, but when engaging with enemies, our performance headroom would drop out, and asynchronous space warp would kick in, dropping our frame rate in half. So rather than pushing things further, I decided to call it here because the game looks and plays great, for the most part, at these settings. Red Matter 2 is a game I've found that seems to favor AMD GPUs, and performance with the 7800 XT was great. It had no problem maintaining 120fps at the settings you're seeing on screen now in the vast majority of the game. There was only a couple times I saw asynchronous space warp kick in while doing my testing. The first was in this lab where I was shining my laser scanning tool to see how the GPU would handle rendering the laser's reflection on both the glass orbs over the table and the glass doors of the cabinets on the left at the same time. The other spot was in this tunnel when I was using the flashlight, and we had multiple dynamic lighting elements all going at the same time. Other than these two moments, the 7800 XT had no problem running this game at 120fps,
and I'm on the right
it
track.
Looked fantastic.
Stars definitely came this way.
Being a game that was designed to run primarily on standalone headsets, Breachers isn't exactly a tough game to run. So the 7800 XT had no problem with this one. The only graphics settings you can adjust in this game is anti-aliasing, and it maxes out at 8x, so that's what I set it to, and this is the performance we got. Another pretty easy game to run is Beat Saber, and the 7800 XT ran this game at 120Hz with all the game settings maxed out and anti-aliasing set to 2x. My 16-year-old daughter is a much better Beat Saber-er than I am, so I enlisted her help on testing this one. And as far as she was concerned, the 7800 XT passed the 120Hz Expert Plus test with flying colors. Going from one of the easiest games I test with to one of the most demanding games I test, we have Lone Echo 2. To be able to keep the render resolution where I like it, I had to set the refresh rate to 90Hz and the in-game settings to what you're seeing now. Lone Echo 2 is a pretty chill, slow-paced game. You don't need a super high refresh rate for this one, in my opinion. It's a very pretty game, though. So the higher you can get the resolution and graphics settings, the better. While we're really close to the limit of the 7800 XT's performance at these settings, it delivered a very nice experience in this game. Blade and Sorcery is a little like the Walking Dead Saints and Sinners, in that when just roaming around, the 7800 XT had no problem running this game at the settings you're seeing on screen. Oftentimes, we had 50 to 60% performance headroom still available. However, when engaging with enemies, that headroom begins to melt away. Usually when testing this game, as soon as I get into a fight with two or more enemies, the performance headroom drops, asynchronous space warp kicks in, and the frame rate is cut in half for the majority of the fight. The 7800 XT, however, has enough power to muscle through these types of engagements most of the time. Performance wasn't completely flawless though, and I did still have times the frame rate would drop out, but it was much less frequent than when I've tested this game in the past with other GPUs. Looking at the performance headroom here, I'm sure you're thinking, surely I could have turned the settings up higher and into the radius. Well, you're not wrong, I could have bumped things up a little bit more, but I wanted to keep the frame rate at a constant 90 FPS. And while I did have quite a bit of performance headroom in most areas wandering around the radius at the settings I chose, there are other areas like this lake here where the 7800 XT met its match. And there's lots of places as you walk around where performance fluctuates up and down pretty dramatically in this game. So I decided to give us plenty of headroom in this one where asynchronous space warp only kicks in the most extreme situations. Assetto Corsa Competizione is the first game I tested with the 7800 XT, where I ended up choosing to turn the render resolution down to 4128 by 2096. And this allowed the game to run at 90 Hz on the VR high preset and the game's resolution scale set to 90%. As you can see, this left us with a pretty consistent 20 to 30% performance headroom remaining, so our frame rate never fell below 90. I always test Microsoft Flight Simulator with the render scaling, world scale, level of terrain detail, and objects level of detail at 100, and every other setting as low as it'll go. To get a constant 90 FPS like you're seeing here in this training flight with those settings, I had to lower the render resolution to 3936 by 1984, which really isn't too bad, especially seeing as we've got a stable 90 FPS going. This means for all you VR pilots out there, you can crank the graphics settings up a good amount and still get a stable 45 FPS. And with asynchronous space warp enabled, things feel pretty good. Switching over to New York City, for the most part, we had a pretty stable 45 FPS. But when I'd turn my head quickly to look around, the frame rate would drop below that, into the 30s and even as low as the 20s, and then come back to 45 once I stayed looking in the same direction for a little bit. For those that do a lot of flying in VR, you know how demanding this game is, and that this kind of performance from the 7800 XT is actually pretty impressive. Overall, I feel the 7800 XT is a pretty impressive GPU for VR, especially when you compare it to the RTX 4060 Ti 16GB and RTX 4070. While I haven't personally tested the RTX 4070, it does share the same $500 to $600 price tier as the 7800 XT, and at that price you get 16GB of VRAM with the 7800 XT, where the 4070 only has 12. I have, however, tested the 4070 Ti, and while the 4070 Ti is more powerful than the 7800 XT, it also costs $300 more than the 7800 XT. And if you ask me, it's not worth that extra money, because in some games, the 7800 XT came really close to matching the 4070 Ti's performance, and wasn't super far behind it in most others. Comparing it to the 16GB 4060 Ti, the 7800 XT mops the floor with it in every game I tested. Yes, you can find deals right now on the 4060 Ti and get it for less than its $499 MSRP. But in my opinion, I think you're better off spending a little more for the 7800 XT and getting the extra performance. Subscribe!